Hey, welcome to another episode of our new series in January called Lead Through Your Bleed, where we talk about people who have definitely overcome adversity, but in the midst of their trial, in the midst of their struggle, had to lead. When they felt like digging a hole and crawling inside it and just shut the world out in their life, they were forced to continue to lead. They felt like that was their calling, to be leaders in those moments when everybody else would have tucked their tail and run away from leadership. These people stared into the face of their trouble and adversity and trial. And today I am privileged to have the guest we have. If you were a college football fan in the early 2000s, this name will ring a bell. If you know anything about Oklahoma football, this name will stand out to you. He might be one of the greatest interior linemen to ever put on an Oklahoma Sooner uniform. His name is Tommie Harris. He is our guest today and was recruited to the University of Oklahoma and became a two-time All Big 12 selection. He was a consensus first-team All-American in 2002, was a unanimous first-team All-American in 2003, was drafted in the first round in the NFL draft in 2004 by the Chicago Bears. He played 8 seasons in the NFL, had a great career, was a Pro Bowler multiple times. It seemed like everything was going well for Tommie Harris as a high-level, prominent defensive player in the NFL. But in 2012, his life was turned upside down by the sudden death of his new wife, Ashley. Tommie then faced many, many emotional struggles, as you can imagine. Tried to battle, tried to stay in the league, but just could not shake the tragedy of losing his wife. And so Tommie got out of the NFL and began healing, began emotional healing, a journey with 2 children, to be a single father, and just really started to tap into some sides of himself that he wasn't necessarily prepared for, but found a way to channel that and to help people, to help young people volunteer his efforts. Tommie became a recording artist and record songs like called Grand Canyon and Deflated, talking about his pain and hardship and loss and heartache. But Tommie now is involved in many efforts, many philanthropic efforts, giving back to the community, to young people. He's just released a book called Endure, Playing Through Life's Hardest Hits, an NFL Player's Story. So that copy is available. That book is available now, and we're going to tell you how to get it. But I really and truly am honored and privileged to welcome Tommie Harris to the Last in Line podcast. Tommie Harris, I speak for all of Sooner Nation and Bears Nation when I say it's an honor to have you, man. Welcome to Last in Line podcast.
Hey, thank you, man. Thank you so much for having me on here, brother.
Man, it's good to see you. I followed your career. Grew up in Oklahoma, so I had 2 small children when you were at OU, and so they got to grow up watching it done the right way, and some might argue the best to ever put on a uniform for the interior line on the defensive side of the ball. So I'm going to say that's bold. That's bold. I know. I don't I don't have to apologize for that, but
you're being nice. Thank you.
No. You're being humble, but I think, man, I started watching your journey a little bit, and man, when you left the NFL, it was like, where did he go? And so I'm raising a family. I didn't get into all the details, but man, found you again and noticed your story. And man, I just wanted the listeners to come on and benefit from some of the wisdom you have. So, you know, like I said, this, you're going to be the first episode of this series we're doing in January called Lead Through Your Bleed. And you spent a lot of time in the NFL. I mean, eight seasons, right? Most of it with the Chicago Bears. Man, just kind of on the lighter side of this conversation, what do you miss most about playing?
Camaraderie. Yeah, that's pretty. The teammates, the locker room, you know, just achieving a goal with the group.
And you consider yourself a competitive guy. So when you get out of that space of formal competition, man, what are you keeping busy doing? I know you've got kids that are in sports. So you kind of living through their competitions, or do you kind of keep that competitive edge some other way?
Yeah, I don't even really have that edge anymore.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm really chilling. I'm floating, man. I'm living. I'm staying out the way. I'm doing what I feel like God has called me here to do. Really not in a haste for anything. Like, I'm really just enjoying my time. My kids, we were just out eating. My phone kept blowing up. My son said, "Dad, you know you didn't talk to us to the end." I was like, "Bro, they only call like 15 minutes and talk." So it's learning how to keep things in a block, like what's really important. And that's what I've spent more of my time trying to do now, and balance a world that you have to have some money to be able to do all that. So that's where I'm at.
Yeah. And you're back in Texas, right? You living in the Fort Worth area? Okay. That's what I thought last time we talked. It's been a few months, but so how old are your kids, and what are they in the middle of? What kind of sports and activities are they doing?
My kids range from 7 to 14.
Yeah.
And they do everything from volleyball to basketball to singing, from choir, like, you know.
That's good.
Pretty much everything. But my son is the one, this is his first year actually. He's in seventh grade, so this is his first year actually competing in sports on a school level.
Well, I mean, I know they get tired of hearing it, but they've got the DNA for it. So, man, that's exciting for you.
Dana.
Huh?
We call it Dana. That's
it. Well, man, I was watching I had no idea. Now, did you grow up singing all your life in church, or just kind of in the shower like the rest of us? Because I had no idea you could sing to that level when I started hearing your music coming out. So how's that music background take shape?
Man, I grew up in church. You know, my dad was a singer. Come from a family of singers and musicians. So I had no choice growing up in church my whole life.
Yeah, but that don't mean you just automatically gonna have a good voice and an ear
for
it.
My daddy can sing. You know, my dad is I get my voice from my father, man. My dad's a heck of a performer, singer. He can do a lot. So I really didn't even sing in church. I just sung after church was over with.
You know,
I was shy of it. I'm just now getting over the shyness.
Really?
Yeah.
How old are you now?
38.
Okay. And you're just coming out of your shell. No.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, you did. I want to talk more about music and more about this book that recently released. But, tell the audience a little bit about your faith journey coming up. I mean, this is a faith-based servant leadership podcast. And you grew up in church, and that doesn't always mean that we own our faith, you know, because my kids grew up in church and they have to take ownership of that. So at what point kind of did the light go on with you spiritually where you said, this is mine? It's not because I got taken to church growing up. It's because I choose. This is the life I want.
Man, I would pretty much say 7.
Really?
Yeah, like I've always just been in love with God. And I've always learned at 7, like, no matter what I do, he still loves me.
Mm-hmm.
And I was born in Germany. I had a great Sunday school teacher that I learned from all different aspects of white, black, brown. I grew up with all of them. And I just learned that God was love at an early age. And it's always trying to keep myself to remember that. And whenever I get in those places of trying to judge myself or think that I could ever be enough to make God even more happy than he was when he created me, that's what I spend most of my time silencing. Like, God, when I found out that God loves me, it was over, bro. So I've always been in that gap of reminding myself to remember that, and that's my salvation. So mine is different than everyone else's, talk about when it comes to their faith, who Jesus is. It's to remember that God is love, and that's what I've always started to stay in. Whenever I get in phases of my life where I feel like I don't love God anymore, or God, I always remember that, Tommie, it doesn't matter. God loves you. And that's what always brings me back to God all the time. And we all get lost.
Yeah.
I don't care who you are, no matter what age you are, that this is a daily renewal of the mind. It's not something, well, when I was 12, I gave my life to Christ. Well, you did it again at 13 and 14, like, if you want to be honest.
Yeah.
So that's where I'm at. It's a daily journey of remembering how much God loves me. And that's what always brings me back to him.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you definitely grabbed onto that at an earlier age than most. And, you know, being that it's more than religion, it's a relationship. And it sounds like you had those people, those mentors that showed you that and taught you that. And
I didn't, bro.
Oh, you didn't have even your Sunday school teacher? No.
Well, just the Sunday school teacher was to tell me that at such an early age.
Right.
And then my mom would always tell me, this life is not yours. You were supposed to die when you were born. And I held you to God and said, if you make it through the night, he'll serve you to the day he dies.
Whoa.
So my mom was telling me that all the way up to, and something just clicked where I recognized that I never agreed with what my elders were saying about who, and it, I knew it didn't take this much work, and it don't like I'll see my parents be one way on Sunday and do Monday through Saturday, be a whole nother way. Like, that's what I spent most of my time observing, the culture of religion, the culture of the secular world, trying to find a space. Okay, because some people say they're one thing. Now, do I judge them when I see them do a regular thing that I do, but I haven't get caught? And you know what I mean? It was just trying to always come to a realness of what is this thing called Christianity?
Yeah.
What is this thing called beliefs? And what is it like? Everyone has their own way. We talk about one God, but you're seeing everyone display it in a, well, you punch him back in the mouth, but ain't you a pastor? I don't care. If somebody tell you, like, so it's rules to when you could come out, you can take it off when you want to, you know,
right.
So it's always been on the journey of that, bro.
Yeah, no, that's good. I'm glad you said that, because that breaks it down pretty real for a lot of folks that are, you know, feel like they compartmentalize their life Monday through Friday or whatever, Monday through Saturday, and different areas of their life that they segment into this. And then this is over here. I'm a different person. Well, you know, I'm glad to hear you say that it's been a process, and it is a process, continuous process. So let's fast forward a little bit and, you know, highly, highly recruited, out of Killeen, Texas, to come to the University of Oklahoma, where you were obviously all American, 2002, 2003, and was in the first round draft pick in 2004 draft, I believe. So you're on this your career is doing exactly what you had hoped it was doing football wise, and you just at the top of this ladder. Man, what about your faith? Was it ever challenged? I mean, I know you say it's challenged every day, but like in that environment of being a pro athlete and different climates that you can be exposed to, like, did you have some slippery moments of, man,
I had more than slippery moments. I fell, you know?
Yeah.
And I learned that God still loved me.
Oh yeah.
And I had to get back up. So, and it's learning that constant coming back to God, like, you're never going to be enough that God won't stop teaching you. And you never not can be enough that God won't go down and reach you. And it's recognizing that it's God's love that's doing that. And that's what keeps you, that you learn. See, most people beat themselves up for the sin they did yesterday, but didn't know that if they ask for forgiveness and God forgives, you could take that energy, that behavior, and it'll encourage you to get up tomorrow. But depression is living that mistake that happened 2 years ago, and you can't get back up again because you're beating yourself up over something that happened in 2018 and it's 2020. Like,
yeah,
it's renewing of the mind. You're going to slip. You're going to fall. Especially if God gives you another breath, you're learning here. You don't have all the answers, and that's what keeps you near the cross. And the more you know that it's God's work that's working in me, and some days are ugly, some days are, but I'm committed to being, there's nothing I can do that will make God stop loving me.
Yeah. Well, so why do we have a problem getting there as people? Is it because we have such conditional terms to our love, and so we can't grasp the fact that he's going to love us anyway?
We as humans are complicated, and God is too, he's so simple. So it makes God as simple. God is, he's not that complicated. Humans are complicated. So we listen to so many humans tell us their experiences in God, that, and they can't just say it how simple he is. Love him and he'll love you back. Even if you don't love him, he loves you back. Like, it's a simple aspect. It's nothing that you got to keep doing over and over and going back and forth. And in the renewing of the mind is just committing and telling God, God, I know I am a sinner. I was born in this world as one. You know it. You weren't off playing golf when you created me.
Yeah.
Out of my mother's womb, you predestined. You knew before me, whatever it is in this life, what is going, I believe that God already knows. If he woke me up this morning, everything in this thing is ordained
right
for my, that's my mind. You understand? I'm not looking for a pastor to tell me if that's right or not, or that, but that's what allows me to behave with my children a certain way, keep my family a certain way. I'm not asking anyone for their advice. Because guess what? There's no bunk beds in the casket.
Hello.
Yes, sir. I got to do this and face my God by myself. So I can't bring all your opinions with me. I have to have an earnest heart before God every night. You don't know how hard I pray every day. You don't know what I'm asking God to do in delivering me. And man will rush God's process in you. So you got to be, you can't let everyone tell and speak into you. You can mess up and have mistakes, and not saying just go out there. But I'm saying, trust God. There's a lot of people that's going through different family background patterns, different things that have become accepted, okay, in their lives, but they want God to deliver me from this thing that I've seen happen on, and I become good at this thing. There's going to be a lot of preparation for practice, right? When you want to change, I tell all the kids when I go talk to them, if you live in an area or a community that you lack love and you want love, your job is to practice it. Practice it to that teacher that you're afraid to hug. Practice it to that every, you cannot make it to the NFL, make it to the military, make without practice. Everything takes a practice. And that's what I'm going to spend more of my time, whatever I'm trying to grow at in my life. I'm in the version of 38 of me that God has allowed to still be here. Yeah. And with God's grace, I pray for another day tomorrow that I can, whatever I do, I mess up, I can clean it up, and he'll give me another chance to show up and get things right.
Yeah.
But that's where I spend most of my time, man, just really just trying to be the best version of me and the most authentic I can be.
I never heard it put like that when you said God's simple and people complicated. Like, I think that's a great perspective, man. That take is not common. I don't hear that very often. And that's a great way. I'm going to have to think about this a little more today. About how we complicate it, and he's pretty simple. So you know, you're in the league, and you're talking about, yeah, we all have moments, temptation, sin, slip ups, different things, man. Were you able to, cause talk a little bit to the listeners about the value of having that group around you, or a couple of accountability people, or just like-minded people to kind of go through a season of life with. I mean, did you have that, or were you kind of isolated?
Yeah,
yes, that?
Yeah. We had that. We had a, I mean, on a team, our chapel would be full of probably about 28, 30 guys out of the 60 something on the, so our, you know, but our leader was Levy Smith. So that there wasn't a hard culture to, it's like God blessed me to be in a culture that was for manhood and football. It wasn't just about football. You know, you were, He was going to teach you how to dress like a man, look appropriate, talk a certain, like that's what you got at that era in Bears football with Lovey. He was more than just a football coach. He was a man of God, just came from Dungy, you know, so there was a lot. The culture there was totally different than a lot of other locker rooms I went to.
Yeah, that's a good pedigree, Tony Dungy. Like, that's a good upstream leader to have, and then he just
Billy Graham coming down from the Billy Graham.
Hey, that dude. Yeah, he is the Billy Graham of the NFL.
Right. That's
the Well, you had some guys and had a good turnout at Chapel, and that's good, man. I hope that's common. And I don't know. Maybe I'm just naive, but I hope that's common throughout the league, and maybe it's less common today than it was back in, you know, the early 2000s when you were there. But so for the audience, that there's some folks that are going through some stuff, and it's the holidays right now. We're recording this about 4 days before Christmas, and there's some people going through some hardship, some loss, some tragedy, different things. And you had your version of that, and probably a wound that, I mean, not probably, there's nothing that compares on the football field injury wise to losing a loved one, let alone a spouse. And in 2012, your wife Ashley passed away, and I don't know the details of all that. From what I'm gathering, it was very surprising and very like out of the blue suddenly. I'm going to read that, by the way. I'm going to get that shirt. That's what I was going to ask you. We got to get later. We got to get a link on the website to buy one of those. So 2012, man, it was like no other year that you've ever had in your life. So can you take us through some of the situation losing Ashley, and then maybe even just kind of afterwards what you were faced with and had to kind of filter through?
Yeah, so I lost my wife probably 41 days after our marriage. She went to have a routine breast reduction. A day after the surgery, she passed away in the clinic place. Well, she didn't pass away. She had a brain aneurysm on the table. Mm-hmm. But they kept her at the house or something went on. But I come down, get the news. I wait for 3 days and recognize that she was brain dead. And I found that out as people were coming in to get her organs. Her organs were being donated while I just found out over the internet that she was brain dead. All this happened like within minutes. And I remember sitting across from the room and watching people come in. I asked the doctor, I said, why is everyone in there? And they said, well, she was an organ donor. And you know, I didn't know when you're organ donor, you can't reverse that, you know? So people were just coming in. The doctor thought that I knew that gray matter meant that she was brain dead, but it took me 3 days to understand what gray matter was. So it was a lot that just was going on. But I remember pulling my wife's cord, and the first thing I said was, what is an argument? So I try to remind myself, even in these times, it's almost been 10 years now, like, what is an argument? You know, like, after something's gone, after something's lost, and you got all this money and you can't save it, what is truly an argument? So I'm very, at this age of 38, I'm kind of very sensitive to time and space and who I allow to speak in it with me, and because I'd rather be doing stuff with my kids because I don't have a lot of time. You know what I'm saying? I really know what the time is if we can... That situation in my life sped me up so much, like where I was going. And I think I'll say my wife saved my life. Like, that's my biggest angel, because the guy I was becoming at that time, I really was asking God not to. I didn't like where I was, what the money was doing, what football was doing, what the lifestyle was doing. I was losing a lot of who I was as a person. And I guess that's the regrowth of God, like all these different trials and tribulations. I'll tell any individual that's in them that there is a message in the mess if you can trust God, you know? So whatever it is that we are in a place of feeling like we're lost or absence or financial deficits and COVID's going on, health issues are happening in the land, I just encourage people to just trust God and know that in this place, God was not off doing something, why these things started happening. So it's one of these things that you begin to, even in this place, you have to trust God. I remember waking up the next morning and it said, NFL football player wife has passed from a brain aneurysm. And I looked in the obituary column and I saw my wife's name, and then I saw like 40 other people. So it put me in a perspective that I'm not the only one having this day today. Mm. And I had to start really, I saw God slowed down time for me. I had a chance to see the funeral guy to come in and do the whole funeral right afterwards. You have to start preparing for a funeral. See, people don't know all about this. And you just heard yesterday that she's gone. So you're trying to get this and you're trying to understand all this stuff as fast as possible. And then the next day you got to plan the funeral, find who's going to dress the body, who's going to do this. So you're sitting there dealing with the mortician. And I saw in the mortician's eyes that the mortician was excited because he was doing Tommie's funeral. And that was the biggest amount of, that was a lot of money that they were making. And it wasn't, that's just his job. You realize that if it don't happen to you, it's not your problem, right? And the only thing that makes us really care is having God's heart, like Jesus, that you care for. But I was able to sit down in all these moments and learn, like, whoa, regardless, it's just like football. When you get hurt on the field, the game goes on. So it's really your job in these moments is to find some silence and find some care, solitude, care, and start going to rehab. Finding someone to talk to, finding someone, especially when the wound is freshly open, you can't talk football when you just tore your ACL yesterday. There's something has to happen. A recovery process must take place. So I tell anyone that's going through a difficult time, that's all it is. It's just a difficult time. And this too shall pass. It's like watching a clock hand. It's going to just get, don't quit.
Yeah.
Because it could be the next day. It could be the next moment. Your break is right. You got to stay in this thing because you're not the only one going through something. Yeah. That's like someone having a bad play on the field and they want to quit the whole team. No, we need you out here. Come on, next play.
Right.
Let's go. So I want to encourage anybody that's going through that thing. Like, it's not going to stop. The licks in life going to keep on hitting. They're going to keep to it's how do you perceive it? I'm not the only one that's going through something. And when we're in these moments, it sucks to be you right now. That's what a man came in there and told me to save my life with that statement right after I pulled the cord. It was a guy with a brain aneurysm named KJ. He came in and he had a freshly cut scar on his head. And he said, man, I just heard about your news. What if we can just get one of my doctors to do one more thing? I said, well, do whatever. He sent it to all the best doctors. They came back. They said she had one of the rarest brain slips. He said, Tommie, I tried to help, but we couldn't. Mm-hmm. And he grabbed me real tight to him and he whispered in my ear. He said, it sucks to be you right now, but God trusts you with this pain. Like,
yeah.
Don't let them down, bro. Like,
wow. Well, so you had kids at this point.
Two,
yeah,
by myself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's another aspect of this that people maybe don't always focus on is you got to, like you talk about the games going on, you talk about the next play, you know, next guy up, next play. You're trying to grieve. You're trying to heal, cope at the very least. And you look over and you got two little people that can't take care of themselves. Talk to our listeners about what inside you had to just get turned on. Like that switch had to turn on of, all right, it's time to like game on still, right? You had to take care of them. So what is it in people that maybe, is it just necessity? Is it just survival mode? Or is it just something different that God gives you the power to be able to do that when you don't think you have it?
That's it. But it's not until affliction happens that you know you activate that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like you couldn't tell someone I would be speaking another language if I told someone who's having a perfect day about my struggles, right? Like only people that know struggle care about struggle. or no pain, care about pain. Because the rest, when you have it in your way, you're too busy to, you don't relate. You know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
I feel like something clicks in the individual that you have a, I don't know. It's nothing but God, bro. It's nothing but, I can't say, because I know when I look at my kids today and everyone just thinks like they still have a mom and they don't, and then when we tell them we don't have, like, they don't believe what, like, and I don't, like, I'm like, God has literally been carrying me through this whole time. If it wasn't for God, bro, my faith in God, my belief that God knows all things, that God has everything under control, even in your bad days, right? Even in your bad days, God is still good.
Yeah.
And even beyond that word good, he's necessary. And sometimes you may have to take that in order for other lessons to be learned. That's why I recognize in that with my wife, it was for me to see the mortician and learn that in this world, things still go, the game of life still happens. People are still living in their own place, but it's only for those people that God has hit with pain can recognize those in pain.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it's for, in these moments are special too, when you are in moments of affliction or trials. Not saying that we love them, or, but there's a moment in there that you really, things become, when you go through loss, the sound of that person laugh has more value now. Mm-hmm. When you go through loss, the song that used to listen, we used to just listen to just sporadic, like now when I hear that sound, so it's like, it's such a moment where you can see people. So I asked when you, it sucks to be down right now. It sucks, but there is a value in pulling from this place of God. What if I trust God here still, though? What if I don't take the option of being pissed off, getting mad? Because I can't reverse any of this stuff for real. I really can't.
Yeah.
It's going to suck some days. I get, I'm allowed to cry. I'm allowed to be. But my father always told me, Tommie, you can't unscramble eggs. That's what he told me at my wife's casket.
Oh my gosh.
I thought that my dad is a military man. He's a pastor. He's one of the toughest men I know. I thought this one day he was going to come there and give me some sensitivity. And he whispered in my ear while I was standing right next to my wife, Cassie. He said, man, I love you. He said, but you can't unscramble eggs. He said, you either going to trust God, you either going to talk about it, or you going to eat it.
So did you need to hear that sort of, I don't even know if it's tough love, but you weren't expecting that. Is that something that you look back later and thought kind of needed to hear that? Or were you, how what was your reaction?
I didn't want to hear it at that time.
Right.
I didn't want to hear, but my father knew what I needed.
Mm-hmm.
So my whole life was about that. The coaches that pushed me past the point. If it was up to what I thought, I would have been quit. But the coaches that knew in my eyes that, no, I'm going to make you go another one. I'm going to, you have greatness in you. I'm going to push you past that. So when trials come, we go, they go low, we go high.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? When different, we don't stop. It don't matter. Once you commit yourself to seeing it through and getting over things and becoming an overcomer. An overcomer means that, there's going to be things in front of your life. There's going to be things that happen behind you. But you have to mentally tell yourself, I'm over. I got to get over this in order to run.
Yeah.
In order to continue to feel like you're living in this life, you have to get over something.
Yeah.
But my father, man, that in hindsight,
Well, I
needed all of that. That's what pushed me. That kind of kept me through that whole to now.
It feels like a parallel too, whenever you talked about, cause you said something about your dad, you said, my father knew what I needed, but I didn't want to hear it. And it reminds me of God. Like it reminds me of God right there. Does it not?
Yeah. I mean, listen to that like that.
When you said it, I was thinking, holy smokes, that's the father, not only his earthly father, but our heavenly father knows what we need, but it ain't always what we want to hear. Man, so you wrote a book and I've read some of your devotionals on YouVersion too that are powerful. but you wrote a book called Endure, Playing Through Life's Hardest Hits, an NFL Player's Story. So yeah, hold that up again. We're going to put a link in there for people to be able to get that too. It's on Amazon, right? Man, what was the, talk about playing through life's hardest hits. That's part of the title. What was the hardest hit, I guess, during that process of writing that? Was it hard to unpack all that again, or was it like cathartic as far as like, was it therapeutic for you, or was it just kind
of? It was volatile, right? Like it went between all those different emotions, that like highs and the lows. It's how the book is written, though. Like,
yeah.
And the certain chapters were harder than others. Some made me smile, some made me cry to relive. But at the end, it became cathartic to finish that chapter of my life, because now I feel like I've paid my dues to what I went, and I'm ready to move to the next stage.
So how long has it been out, that book?
October 26th.
Okay. So it's almost been 2 months. So what are you hearing from folks? I can imagine it's been overwhelmingly positive, but what are you reaching that group of folks that just kind of needed to hear that in that moment? Like, you met them right where they were?
Oh yeah. I mean, some people say you basically spoke my feelings. I couldn't say my feelings, but you spoke them out loud. Yeah. I could literally read what I was living through, and no one's been able to connect there with me. Like, I know I'm not crazy, and if you can get through it, that's what it's all about. I teach, if you, in that book, I talk about if I'm an example of, I endured.
Yeah.
I'd endured it. I every day I wish I could reverse it, but I can't. And I wish I could, but we have to keep pushing, but we can't think, well, if I had this and why that happened to me, there's something here that God wants for us to get, even in these places. So the book is about just trusting God through every situation, every hit you get, everything, just to trust God and come back again and never quit, no matter what throw at you.
Yeah. Yeah. Man, I can't wait to read it. And man, your music career, I know you have a couple, I know just the two that I know of that were probably two of the bigger hits, the Grand Canyon and then Deflated. Are you pursuing that further, that music career? Are you trying to add on to those, create an album, a record at all? Or
I'm doing at least two songs a year. That's what I would like to do the rest of my life, but it's not something I just, that's my hobby. You know, that's something I don't want the world to make me hate my hobby.
That's true.
Yeah. So I like to perform when I want to perform. I like to sing when I want. I like to put, I'm cool where I'm at. I'm just putting it out when I feel inspired to write or to sing. I'm going to go in there and write a song. And that's what I'm going to try to do every 2 years. I really enjoy the whole process of music, though. So.
Yeah.
But that's I don't have time for. I'm in the book. I'm starting a second book. I'm starting writing another book. And then I'm starting to get my PhD at NC University. And that's it.
Yeah, I knew you had a master's, right? Am I right? You had a master's. Yeah. Did you get your MBA from OU?
No, Miami University.
Where did you get that? Okay, okay. All right. Well, I knew you had a master's. What do you want to do with that? That PhD? What do you
master or my PhD?
The PhD. What do you want to? What motivates you to go that direction?
I just read. I read a lot on about mental health and psychology, and I wanted to do PTSD and trauma and disaster in communities. Yeah. So just being able to build thinking programs all around different communities to reset focus of what we've been taught here. Yeah. And the only way you can do that is to have a psychology, like a real doctorate degree.
Yeah.
They're not just going to let me come in as a ball player or a master's. I want to tell them I've improved, I'm proven, I proved the science, and I wrote a thesis on it. So I do it all day on regular books. I just write. I do the whole little, I'm not even in school. I said, I might as well get some alphabet letters behind it.
Right. Absolutely. Why not? Why not? Well, man, I wish you luck in that. And I know there's a demand for that. And man, there's a lot of people. There's a huge need for that. So, man, before I let you go, any parting shot for folks that are right in the middle? I mean, it's Christmas time, and either they have suffered some loss recently or they're in the middle of just this darkest time, man. What kind of advice can you give for leading through their bleed?
Leading through their bleed. My advice right now is to just believe. And when you're in these moments of adversity, this is where you believe and you hold on to what God has spoken in your life, what he said to you. And even though they don't believe God, if you're just flinging out there, he's something to hold on. And for the ones that's holding on, I beg of them to never let go, because we need them. We need you in the game, bro. Everyone's going through some hit that is hard to take, but you got a group of guys you can connect with me. I'll help pray with you guys. You can contact me on my TommieHarrisBooking@gmail.com or TommieHarris.com, and we can pray together, whatever, because you're not the only one going through something. So there is a family of people that are focused on real time, not Instagram time, not Twitter time, not these fake times either. When you are in pain, people that are in pain or in a chemotherapy clinic or sitting on dialysis, they can't be racist. It doesn't exist there. And if you are, you're just a bitter bandy. But if in those moments, I recognize that you meet all that stuff is null and void when you're in these places. So it's to be able to reach out to your vulnerability, and these times do have value.
Yeah.
So you're not the only one that is going through something. Get with someone, speak with someone. If you want to, before you even think about harming yourself, tell someone you want to harm yourself. It's okay. Because we need to know, that's the mental health part. Stop trying to hold it in. I'm not. And it's okay not to be okay.
Right.
And once you can speak that out your mouth, we can build a blueprint. We can build a playbook to helping us stay here and continue to toughen through these times.
Yeah,
because that's what it's going to take, a team of believers to make it through these times, bro.
That's right. That's right. Well,
so hold on.
TommieHarris.com, everyone. And Tommy, hey, thank you very much for making time. I know you got your time's precious. And man, I thank you very much. It's been a pleasure, honor to meet you. And I really appreciate this. And audience, I know it was good for you, and I hope you can take away some of Tommy's advice, and he's lived it, so learn from it. And he's been Tommie Harris. We've been Last in Line. Be blessed.